Now we're going to talk about asystole. Asystole means that there is no discernible electrical activity in the heart that can be seen on an ECG monitor, and there's no pulse. Survival rates are very poor when a child or infant is in asystole. This is the reason so much emphasis is placed on prevention of injuries and aggressive treatment of illnesses that could lead to cardiac arrest. In addition, a healthcare provider needs to focus on early recognition and treatment of respiratory distress, respiratory failure, and shock before they actually cause cardiac arrest. Identifying and treating preventable causes of cardiac arrest using the H's and T's is crucial to saving the life of an ill or injured child. If you have a patient that appears unresponsive, start by tapping and shouting to verify. Call for more advanced care. In a hospital setting, this might include calling a code, and in a pre-hospital setting, this may include getting assistance from another ALS unit, if needed, or getting a higher level of transportation. Next, we're going to assess circulation and breathing by checking for a carotid pulse on a child or a brachial pulse on an infant. We should look at the face and the chest at this time for signs of breathing. For a patient with no pulse, CPR should be initiated immediately. For a child or infant, we're going to give two-person CPR with high-quality CPR, and those need to be performed with as few of interruptions as possible by giving cycles of 15 compressions, at least one-third the depth of the chest at a rate of 100 to 120 per minute, followed right away by two rescue breaths. Now, the depth is going to be about 2 inches, and on an infant, about 1.5 inches. The compressor needs to be changed every couple minutes to avoid fatigue. The airway person would measure and prepare a proper sized basic airway adjunct and ventilate with 100% oxygen delivered via bag valve mask at 15 liters per minute. Two breaths would be given after each set of 15 compressions. The defibrillator pads should be applied right away now that compressions and breaths have begun. At this time, the leader calls everyone to stand clear while the rhythm is analyzed. If the patient is in asystole, it's important to double-check some easy things to correct this type of ECG rhythm. First, are all the leads on correctly and are they all attached with good contact? Is there sufficient power given to the ECG? Is the amplitude set correctly so as to determine asystole versus fine V-fib? And if all these are answered yes and working, now the team leader may continue. At this time, the team leader states, let's keep giving high quality CPR because asystole is not a shockable rhythm. Now is the time to move to the IV or IO access in order to begin medications and fluid replacement. A very helpful tool in resuscitation is a length-based color-coded tape, such as a Braslow tape. It can help advanced care providers to determine things very quickly and efficiently, like a child's weight, for calculating drug doses, and for selecting the correct sizes of resuscitation equipment. For example, an average 9-month-old would measure within the red area of a color-coded length-based resuscitation tape. Now, if they're in the red, that would estimate that the infant's weight to be about 8 kilograms. It would also tell us that a 22 to 24 gauge IV catheter should be used, or that an 18 to 15 gauge IO needle should be used. Now, when the IV or the IO is established, the team leader should call for 0.01 milligrams per kilogram of epinephrine, 1 to 10,000, to be delivered IV or IO push. And then remember, it's important to flush that medication with 20 cc's of normal saline. This ensures that the medication gets into the central circulatory system. It's also important that compressions are being given with the medication in order to get it properly circulated. It also make sure that the person is getting the best circulation of oxygenation and we're not taking breaks of CPR while trying to administer medications or start an advanced airway. All of these things are vitally important when it comes to basic life support. Now, in the circumstance that an IO or an IV is not available, but an endotracheal tube is in place, epi could be given down the ET tube. But the ratio of that medication is going to be different. We're going to deliver it 0.1 milligrams per kilogram, but 1 to 1,000. Medications delivered via the ET tube is not as desirable as IO or IV because the results are not as predictable. However, the potential benefit of the medication outweighs the risk. Now, after initial treatment, it is a good time to insert an advanced airway. After an ET tube or another advanced airway is in place, you would move to continuous compressions. Breaths would change to one breath every 2 to 3 seconds. Also, remember to switch compressors every 2 minutes. When the compressor calls for a switch, the airway person would finish a breath. Before the next rescuer begins compressions, it is a good time to do a quick look at the monitor for changes. This should take no longer than 10 seconds before CPR is resumed if there is no change in the rhythm. Capnography should also be attached to monitor compression quality and gas exchange. Repeated doses of epinephrine 0.01 mg per kilogram of 1 to 10,000 IV or IO push should be given every 3 to 5 minutes. Once initial treatments have been started, it's important to ask the team to help in considering potential causes of why this patient went into asystole. To do this, we should consider the reversible H's and T's. These include hypovolemia, hypoxia, hydrogen ion, which is acidosis, hypo or hyperkalemia, tension pneumothorax, cardiac tamponade, toxins, cardiac thrombosis, or coronary thrombosis. It's important to remember that as a healthcare professional, we cannot know when a person may experience a survival that goes against all scientific reason. And so we rescue with enthusiasm. But it's also important to note that many studies have shown that asystole represents what is termed the final rhythm. In other words, cardiac function and electrical activity have been diminished over time until there's no perceivable electric or mechanical activity, and the patient is biologically or permanently dead. However, some circumstances such as poisoning or hypothermia warrant a longer resuscitation effort than others. For example, with victims of drowning in icy water, survival can sometimes be possible after being underwater for as long as 40 minutes and prolonged CPR efforts of greater than 2 hours. When drowning occurs in ice water, rewarming to a core temperature of at least 30 degrees Celsius is recommended before CPR efforts are terminated. This is due to the heart being unresponsive to resuscitative efforts until the core body temperature is increased. It is never an easy decision for a team leader to stop resuscitation efforts, especially for an infant or a child. However, after all the viable treatment options have been attempted, the potential reversible causes have been exhausted, special circumstances have been taken into account, and the patient still remains in asystole, a decision to stop resuscitation will be necessary.